Hello guys, welcome to Bhavna's Online Academy. So in this video, we are going to learn the Accounting Standard 2, which is your valuation of inventories. So in this video specifically, we are going to learn all the concepts of AS2 and also we are going to solve illustrations and examples from ICI material. Yes, so now first, before we begin with the standard, we need to understand why do we have the need to study the standard, right? So whenever you open your balance sheet, and whenever you go to your asset side, under your current asset, you have a component named inventory. So you write a component which is named as inventory. So whenever you, see the balance sheet, there is a value that has been put against each item or each component. So as far as inventory is particularly concerned, here inventory is written 1000 rupees. Okay. So we study the standard to know and to understand how do they arrive at this value of 1000 rupees. What are the components that are being included in this 1000 rupees and what are the components which are being excluded from these 1000 rupees. So basically, you will understand and you will know by the end of the standard that how do you arrive at this value of 1000 rupees. Correct. So this is what we are going to understand in this standard. Okay. So now we need to understand what are the components that are going to get included under the term inventories. So as you all know, inventories is an asset. Inventory is an asset. Here, three components basically are going to get covered under your inventories. Your finished goods, your raw material and your work in progress. So first you buy the raw material. You work on it and it becomes a semi-finished good, or we call it as work in progress. And you, once you complete your complete production process, it turns into finished goods. So all these three items will get included in your inventories. So now we need to understand, how do you measure the value of inventories? Like I first itself, you know, in the beginning of the lecture, I told you that we need to understand how this 1000 rupees came here. Correct. So how do you measure your inventories? Okay. So in your books, what is the cost that you will write in your books? So there is a formula which you need to use to arrive at the value of inventories, which is cost or NRV, whichever is lower. NRV means net realizable value. So cost or net realizable value, whichever is lower, that value you have to take and place it in your balance sheet. Okay. So cost means the cost at which you have brought, you have, you know, purchased your inventory, correct? And net realizable value is the value at which you're going to sell the inventory. Finally, by selling the inventory, what is the value that you're going to get in hand? The realizable value, that is your net realizable value. So cost or NRV, whichever is lower. So now it is not as easy as it seems. Okay, so we need to understand what are the components that are included in cost and what are the components that are included in net realizable value. So how do you calculate the cost of inventory and how do you calculate the net realizable value of inventory is what we have to understand. After that only we'll be able to compare both of them and find whichever is lower, and that value we'll take and put it in our balance sheet. Right. Okay. So first, let's start by understanding how do you calculate net realizable value. How do you calculate net realizable value? Okay. So as I already told you that inventories is being split into three parts. One is raw material, other is finished goods, and the last one is your work in progress. So first, let's see how do you calculate net realizable value for finished goods and WIP. Okay. Or work in progress. So for FG and WIP, how you calculate net realizable value is, the net realizable value means what? The final value that you're going to get in hand after selling a product. So the selling price of the product or the selling price of the inventory minus the cost of completion. So when will you be able to sell a product? Will you be able to sell a product? Now see, what has happened is we have a business of hide and seek biscuit. Okay, when will you be able to sell this biscuit? When it is fully packed and fully ready, correct? If the hide and seek biscuit is only a half made, it is yet to be, we can say it is yet to be baked to make into a biscuit, and the baking process has not yet happened and it is still, in the process of production itself. At that time itself, can you sell the, unbaked biscuits? No, you cannot do that. You need to bake the biscuit to make it into a proper form and then sell it. So whatever cost you're going to incur in completion, that you have to reduce from the selling price, because to sell it yet you have to first complete the whole process, and for completing that process there is a cost that is going to be incurred. So selling price minus cost of completion and minus the selling expenses. So whenever you sell it, now suppose we are selling it for 100 rupees, okay? And if you have to sell it for 100 rupees, there is a few process that you have to complete it, and for completing the process it will take 20 rupees, okay? So 20 rupees you have to reduce from that. Now finally they are saying you have to also reduce selling expenses. Now what might happen is this biscuits you might not be able to directly sell in the market, so you will have a few agents or a few retail customers or wholesalers who will sell the biscuits for you. So for them they will charge a commission to sell that, suppose. Okay, so that commission or that brokerage are your expenses that you make for selling the good or selling your final product or selling your inventory. So that selling expenses also you have to reduce from this. So minus selling expenses will be 10 rupees, suppose. So the final value, whatever you arrive, so 100 minus 30, 70 rupees will be your net realizable value of finished goods or WIP. Finished good or WIP. Okay. Yes. So now we have to understand net realizable value of raw material. How do you calculate? So first you need to understand that we do not calculate net realizable value for raw material, because raw material directly in the market you are never going to sell. So for that, that is not our business to sell raw material. Like the core raw material you buy only to manufacture your final good and then sell it. So raw material you are never going to sell. So it does not have any net realizable value, or basically your selling price. So you will always value it on the cost. Okay. So now we have understood how net realizable value is calculated for finished goods or WIP, and then for raw material, you know there is no NRV. Now we need to understand, so we have understood the first part here, cost, how is it being calculated? So cost also, again, we have split up into two. For FG and WIP, there is one method, and to find out the cost of raw material, there is one method. So how do you find out the cost of finished goods or WIP? First, what you do is cost of purchase. So cost of purchase of raw material, basically, okay, that you have to take. Okay, so once you purchase the raw material, what you have to do, you have to convert the raw material into finished goods. So for the converting that, plus the cost of conversion also you have to add. So that is one more cost to you, and plus other cost, like your labor, or your fuel cost or your power cost, all of these will also get included, and all these costs together will make up your cost of FG or WIP, correct? So now under cost of purchase, cost of conversion and other cost also, I have a few more points to discuss. So we'll first discuss that and then move on to cost of raw material. So first, cost of purchase. So cost of purchase, so what and all is included under cost of purchase? So as you can see here, first the basic purchase price of raw material. So you go for making the hide and seek biscuit, you go and buy maida, and that maida cost you around 50 rupees, suppose. Okay, so that is your purchase price of raw material. Now above that, what happens is you have to pay tax, correct? To buy that maida, you will pay tax. So if there is any non-refundable tax, you have to add it. Suppose you have paid a tax of 5 rupees more. Okay. Here you have to understand the term non-refundable, because in case you are paying a tax and if you will get credit on it later, okay, that means then in such case you need not add the tax here. Only if it is a non-refundable tax and you will not be able to revive it, or you will not be able to take credit on it later, then in such case you need to add the tax. Okay. Next, carrying cost. So what will happen is, once you bring in the raw material itself, directly you will not send it into production process. There might be time where the raw material will have to wait in the warehouse so that it has been sent, it can be sent to the production process, and then the finished goods can be also made. So that cost will also get added here. Carrying cost means your storage cost, basically. Okay, so that cost can will be also added here. Then is inward insurance cost. What is inward insurance cost? Is basically raw material from some other supplier you are going to buy. That supplier will send that raw material till your factory place. Now when this raw material is being sent from that supplier place to your factory, what will happen is, in between, anything might happen to the raw material. It might, due to accident, the whole raw material might get wasted, or bad might happen when it is in transit, okay, when it is going from the supplier's place to your factory. So for that you can get some insurance, right? So that inward insurance cost also, that is one of your costs, so that you will add it in the cost of purchase. Then you have to subtract a few things. First is a trade discount. If a trade discount is given to you, that means on the purchase price, they are giving you some discount so that you can reduce. But in case if they give you cash discount, that you do not have to reduce. Okay, that you don't need to do anything, just ignore it. But trade discount, reduce it from the cost. Then quantity discount also you can reduce it from the cost. And then finally, the duty drawbacks also you can reduce it from the cost. So if you do all of these, finally you will arrive at your cost of purchase. Okay, so I hope you understood this. Next is your cost of conversion. So here, cost of purchase is done. Now we are moving to cost of conversion. So cost of conversion, what does cost of conversion means? When you have to convert your raw material, you have to convert your maida into your finished goods, that is your hide and seek biscuit, then in such case there are a few processes that have to run, and for those processes to run you will require labor, you will require fuel, you will require a factory for which you have to pay a factory rent, you will require power, electricity, all of these which is directly helping in the raw material to get converted into finished goods. Those costs will primarily get included in your cost of conversion. Okay. So, in cost of conversion, there are a lot of overheads which you can incur, but basically the overheads can be divided into two. One is variable overheads and the other one is fixed overheads. So, what is variable overheads? Depending on your production units or depending on your capacity of how much you produce, your variable overheads are going to vary. Higher the production, higher the variable cost. Lower the production, lower the variable cost. Whereas fixed cost does not move like that. Correct. So variable cost you can calculate on per unit basis, and whatever cost is there you can charge it on the product. But in case of fixed overhead, what happens is that there is one formula that you have to use. Okay, you have to first compare actual production and normal capacity. Okay, what they are trying to tell you is here, if you see normally in a factory, if everything is going as per standard and everything is going as per rule, in your factory you can normally produce 10,000 units of hide and seek biscuits. 10,000 units of hide and seek biscuits. But this is your standard that you think if everything goes in a right way, 10,000 units can be produced. But what actually is going to be produced can be different than what you had planned also, correct? So now what might happen is your actual production of hide and seek biscuits might either be higher, that is 15,000 units, or maybe equal as what you have planned and what is your standard, that is 10,000 units, or it might also be lower because of a few reasons, and it can go down up to 5,000 units also. So your normal capacity is your standard capacity, but your actual production might fluctuate up and down or can be same also. Okay. So what you have to do is you have to compare your actual production with your normal capacity. If your actual production is higher or more than, I mean, if it is higher than your normal capacity, then how will you find out fixed overhead per unit is total fixed overhead divided by actual production you will do. Okay. But if your normal capacity is higher or even equal to your actual production capacity or your actual production, then in such case, you will find out the fixed unit, fixed overhead per unit. How will you find out this total fixed overhead divided by normal capacity? So if actual production is higher, then divided by actual production. If your normal capacity is higher, then divided by normal capacity and find the per unit rate. Or even if it is equal, actual production and normal capacity, then there's no point. But still, we can say that you can take your normal capacity. Okay. So this is how you will find out your fixed overhead per unit and then charge it on the product. Okay. I hope you would have understood this. So then finally, you have your other cost. Other cost. So here, see, we have completed cost of purchase, cost of conversion, and finally other cost. If you add, you will get your cost of finished good or WIP. So what and all is included in other cost? So in other cost, you will include all the costs which is incurred to bring the finished goods to present location and condition. Okay. So, example, your packing cost, your quality control cost, your research and development cost, anything which brings the finished goods in such a position that now it can be sold, that will be included in your other cost. Okay. Yes. So, these are the components of costs of FG or WIP. One thing that you have to remember is the exclusions from cost, your exclusions from cost. So, what and all will not be included in the cost of FG or WIP is first your selling and distribution cost, because this comes under your selling expenses, right? then your administration cost, interest and finance charges, your storage cost. Storage cost, one condition is there, until and unless it is not very necessary for the finished goods to be stored in such a way, then only it can be sold. For example, there might be one kind of a finished good where it says only if you store it in 20 degrees Celsius for 24 hours, after that only you can sell it out. So like that, if compulsory storage cost have to be incurred for the product to be sold, then that is fine. Otherwise, that storage cost will not be included in your cost. Okay. Then finally, your abnormal loss or cost, like your theft, all of these will also not be included in your cost. So five costs will not be included in your cost. One is selling and distribution, administration, interest and finance, storage cost subject to a condition, and abnormal loss or cost. Okay, fine. Then finally, now we have to understand how do you calculate your cost of raw material? How do you calculate your cost of raw material? So for calculating your cost of raw material, what you have to do is you have to compare between your cost of finished goods and selling price of finished goods. Your cost of finished goods and selling price of finished goods. Why do you compare cost of finished goods and selling price of finished goods? Is because that raw material at the end, what is it going to get converted into? It's going to get converted into your finished goods, right? So you first compare the cost of finished goods with your selling price of finished goods. So here what you do is, usually what should happen, if I am producing a hide and seek biscuit and the cost for me is 10 rupees, then I will sell it at a 5 rupees profit and I will sell it at a price of 15 rupees in the market. Correct. So ideally the situation should be that your selling price is higher than your cost. Your selling price must be higher than your cost, or at least your selling price must be equal to your cost if it is at the starting stages of business. Okay. So at that time what will happen is your raw material cost will be the same as the purchase price of raw material. That means that whatever price you have purchased the raw material, same can be considered as the cost of raw material itself. But in case, what happens here is that my business is, the people did not like the taste of hide and seek biscuit. Now what is happening? I am producing it at a cost of 10 rupees, but I am only able to sell it at a cost of 5 rupees, because only if I sell it at 5 rupees, people are buying. So in such case, what happens? Your selling price is lower than your cost of finished goods. So here, what will you think? In the near future, we would want to close down the business itself. So if you want to close down the business, what will happen to the raw material that is there? That you're going to replace with some other raw material and get a new raw material for starting a different business. So in such case, if your selling price is less than your cost price of finished goods, then your raw material cost will basically be the replacement cost of raw material. So that replacement cost will be your cost of raw material. I hope you understood until now. Okay, so now we have understood what is the meaning of inventories. How do you measure inventories? Cost or NRV, whichever is lower. NRV, how you have to find, I've told you. And cost also, how you have to find, I've told you. So two points that you have to understand in relation to measurement of inventories is that there might be a lot of inventories in a company. Okay, A, B, C, D, E. Now, here, how are you going to value the inventory? First, before going to that, when will you value these inventories? Are you going to value these inventories once it is produced, or once it is brought into your factory, or on which date will you see cost or NRV, whichever is lower? What did I tell you? You perform this cost or NRV, whichever is lower, because you have to write the value in your balance sheet. So as on balance sheet date itself, you can do cost or NRV, whichever is lower, and find out the value of inventory. Okay. And the next thing is this inventory valuation. If there are A, B, C, D, E, and a lot of type of inventories, for all those inventories clubbed together, for the total value of inventories, will you do cost or NRV, whichever is lower? Or for first, you will see for A, cost or NRV, whichever is lower. For B, cost or NRV, whichever is lower. C, cost or NRV, whichever is like this, you'll do. So here, you have to remember that you have to do item by item basis only. You should not do it in a total basis. Okay. Yes. So now we have understood that, and then we have a final topic, which is joint and byproduct. So for joint and byproduct, how are you going to find out the cost is what we have to understand now. Okay, so now we were talking about one topic which here we came across for finished goods and WIP. There is one cost, which is your cost of conversion. you know that we have to add to find out the cost of finished goods or WIP. Now what might happen is there might be two kinds of products. One is joint product and the other one is byproduct also. Okay. So this I'm talking about other than usual product, these two kinds of output can also be there. So what is joint product? Joint product means you will put in one input, but when the whole production process is run, at the end you will get two outputs. At the end you will get two outputs. Okay. So this is what is known as your joint product. So here in joint product, how will you find out the cost of conversion? How are you going to find out the cost of conversion is what we are going to understand now. So what you have to do is you have to split up this cost of conversion between the two, between product A and product B. Both are your end products. Between product A and product B, you have to divide it. And at what ratio are you going to divide this cost? At what ratio are you going to divide this cost is what you have to understand. Now suppose you have incurred a cost of conversion of total 100 rupees. Now between A and B, how are you going to split it? Okay, so what you can do is this ratio, you can split it at using these three parameters and any one of these three. First, you can take the sale value at the time of separation. That means in a production process, after the production process is over, at that time itself, if you sell the product A and B, what is the value you are going to get? At that value ratio, you can split up this 100 rupees of cost. Or sale value of final products. That means after all the further processing and all is done, at this point when you are going to sell A and B, at what ratio you are going to sell it at, or what price you are going to sell it at that price ratio you can split up your cost of conversion. Or finally, this is also the same only, sale value of final product minus further processing cost. So we can take this out, the final point out. So these two you can remember. Okay, so at that ratio you have to split your cost of conversion. And then finally, in the case of byproducts, how are you going to find out the cost of conversion? What you have to do is you have to take in byproduct case, what will happen is after the production process is over, you will get one main product and one side product. So this product is not needed for us. This main product will be our core business product. Correct. So this product, so how are you going to find out is that main product cost minus the net realizable value of this side product or byproduct. That means when you sell out this byproduct, what value you are going to get. So that net realizable value you have to write here. So main product minus net realizable value of the byproduct will be your cost, will be your cost. Okay. So this is something that you have to remember, and this is what is also given here. Okay, so now that we have completed all our concepts, we are going to move on to see the illustrations and examples that are given in the ICAI book, and we'll quickly run through it. Okay, so first what they are saying is in illustration number 2, there is a X Limited company and it has purchased goods at the cost of 40 lakh rupees. Okay, and out of those goods, 75% of the stocks were sold out. That means 25% of the stocks are still there in the company. What they are telling is this 25% stock which is there in the company, they want to disclose that closing stock at 10 lakh rupees. Okay. And the expected sale value of such stock is 11 lakh rupees. And for them, they will also have to pay a commission of 10% on such sale. So at what value will you record it? Will you be recording the closing stock, or what is the correct value they are asking? The company wants to disclose it at what value? 10 lakh rupees. But at what value should you correctly disclose the closing stock? You have to find out now. So what did they first tell you? What is the cost of the closing finished goods? They told you that the cost of the closing finished goods will be the cost that they purchased. That is your 40 lakh rupees into how much percent is left? 25% is left. So 40 lakh into 25%, 10 lakh rupees will be your cost of the closing inventory which is there. Now you have to find out your net realizable value of your closing inventory. So what will be your net realizable value? Net realizable value will be whatever your sale value is minus your conversion cost minus your selling expenses. So what is your selling price? Your selling price is 11 lakh rupees as stated here. Minus cost of conversion, there is no cost of conversion. Minus selling expenses, 10% at commission on sale. So minus 10%, you will be in 9.9 lakh rupees. So your cost is cost of closing FG is 10 lakh rupees, whereas your net realizable value is 9.9 lakh rupees. So what is the rule that we apply? Cost or NRV, whichever is lower. So NRV 9.9 lakh rupees, at this value only you have to value your closing inventory. Okay, here company told that they want to disclose it at 10 lakh rupees, but what value should they disclose? 9.9 lakh rupees. So they are wrong. Okay, next. They are telling you that the cost, net realizable value and inventory value of two items that a company has in its inventory are given below. So here they have given you the cost of few items and net realizable value of few items. You have to find out the total value. Okay, so how will you find out? Should you do on total basis or should you do item by item basis? I have already told you, you have to do item by item basis. So item 1, cost or NRV, whichever is lower. NRV is lower. So we'll write that. Item 2, cost or NRV, whichever is lower. Cost is lower. So cost, you'll write that. So 45,000 plus 20,000, total 65,000. At this value only, you will record your inventory in the balance sheet. Next is also similar example only. So cost or NRV, whichever is lower, you have to do. So cost is 40, NRV is 28. Here you can see. Cost is 40, NRV is 28. So 28 rupees will be the value. Cost is 32, NRV is 32, any value you can take, so it's 32. Here cost is less and NRV is higher, so less, lower only you have to select, so 16 you will select. So if you total all of these three, 76 will be your value of inventory. So this both were based on the principle of cost or NRV, whichever is lower. Next illustration. Next example. So here they tell you that cost of a partly finished unit, that is a work in progress or a semi-finished unit, is 150 rupees. If you do a further expenditure of 100 rupees, it will be made into a finished good. Okay. The finished unit which you make can be sold at a price of 250 rupees, subject to a payment of 4% brokerage on selling price, which is nothing but your selling expenses. So you have to now determine the value of inventory. Value of inventory is cost or NRV, whichever is lower. First, what is the cost of WIP? They have already told you that the cost of work in progress is 150 rupees. Okay. Next is, what is the net realizable value of work in progress? You have to find it. What is the net realizable value formula? Selling price, which is 250 rupees, minus the cost of completion. That is, the cost that you will incur to complete it into a finished good. So it is 100 rupees more, minus selling expenses at 4%. 4% of what? 4% on selling price. So 4% of 250 rupees, it is your 10. And then you will arrive at the net realizable value of WIP at 140 rupees, and the cost of WIP is 150 rupees. So cost or NRV, whichever is lower, NRV is lower. So 140 rupees is the value at which you are going to value your inventory, basically. Okay, so I hope you understood this. Then the next example, here see. Here you are required to value the inventory per kg of finished goods. So here what they basically tell you is that they have given the material cost per unit, the labor cost per unit, variable cost per unit, and then they have given you fixed production charge. Total fixed cost is 20 lakh rupees, and they tell you that you have a normal working capacity of 2 lakh kgs. Okay, and then they also tell you that finished goods are in stock at the end of the year. That means your closing stock of finished goods is 4000 kgs. So here what you have to basically do is find out. So first what you do is you have to find out your per unit cost. So material cost is 200 per unit. Labor cost is 40 per unit, same. Variable cost will also be 20 per unit. Now for fixed cost, I told you how you have to find out your fixed cost per unit, if you remember. Compare your actual production and normal capacity and find it out that way. But here they have not given you normal capacity and actual production. So in such case, when actual production number is missing, directly you can take your normal capacity itself. So you have to do total fixed cost divided by your normal capacity. So total fixed cost is 20 lakh rupees divided by a normal capacity 2 lakh rupees. So fixed cost per unit will be 10. So your total cost will be 200 plus 70, which is your 270 rupees. Okay, so 270 rupees will be your cost per unit. This is your cost per unit. Okay, so finally, if you have to find out what is the cost of 4000 kgs of finished goods, you will do 4000 kgs into 270 per unit. So 1080,000 rupees will be your cost of inventory, which you have to record it in your balance sheet. Okay, so usually remember, material cost and labor cost, since it is a variable cost and it depends depending on the production, it will be calculated on actual production basis only. Only your fixed overhead, you have to decide between whether normal capacity or actual production. Okay, yes. So there is one more example related to fixed overhead. This I have just decoded it in the site, so we'll go through that itself. In the question, they tell you that there is a normal capacity of a business to produce 1 lakh units. Okay, so and there and what they tell us that fixed overhead cost is 18 lakh rupees. So 18 lakh rupees is the total fixed cost and the normal capacity is 1 lakh units. And what will be the fixed overhead per unit? So it will be 18 lakh divided by 1 lakh. 18 rupees. Okay. Here in this case, only normal capacity was given. In the second case, they have given you normal capacity is 1 lakh rupees. Actual capacity is also 1 lakh. Sorry, 1 lakh units. Actual capacity is also 1 lakh units. So here you need not differentiate. It's there itself, I told you, if your actual production units and your normal capacity units are same, then in such case, you can take your normal capacity itself as a base. So you'll do total fixed cost by normal capacity. Next case, they have given you actual capacity is 0.9 lakh or 90,000 only, whereas your normal capacity is more than it, which is 1 lakh rupees. So whichever is higher, you have to take. So normal capacity and actual production, if you compare, if normal production, normal capacity is higher, you have to take that as your denominator. So it is 18 lakh divided by 1 lakh units. Finally, your actual capacity is 1.2 lakh units, which is higher than your normal capacity. So whichever is higher only you will take. So 18 lakh divided by 1.2 lakh, which is your actual capacity, you will do and find out your answer. So here I already told you, whichever is higher will only come as your denominator. Okay. So we have, I think, one final sum left, which is a quite a different sum from what we have already studied. Okay, so here what they tell you is a trader has purchased a certain article for 85,000. So cost what he has spent to purchase it is 85,000. He is saying some of the articles, not all the articles, but some of the articles he has sold it at 1,05,000 rupees. So selling price here was 1,05,000 rupees. Then he tells that the gross margin is 25% on cost. That means his gross profit is 25% on cost, which is 25% of 85,000, which is 21,250. Okay. Opening stock of inventory is 15,000. So opening cost of inventory, which is your cost of opening inventory, is 15,000 units. Okay. Then he tells you find out the closing inventory value. Closing inventory value you have to find out. So first what you do, you take the sale price of opening stock. What was the sale price of opening stock? 15,000. Okay, that is the cost plus 25%. Okay, so cost of opening stock is 15,000 plus, if you add 25%, it will become your sale value of opening stock. So 15,000 plus 25% profit, and the sale value of your purchase will be 85,000, which is the cost, plus 25%. So it will be 1,25,000 rupees in total. So sale value of opening stock plus sale value of purchase, total will be 1,25,000. Here I did not do anything. I took the cost of opening stock and added the profit percentage, and I took the cost of purchase and added the profit percentage. Okay. So this is your sale value. Okay. This is the expected sale value, but how much actual sales you have done? 1,05,000 only. So the remaining inventory sale value, so the remaining value of inventory, or for the amount for which such inventory can be sold, is 20,000 only. The remaining inventory can be sold at a sale value of 20,000. Now, so this is your closing inventory. So this is your closing inventory can be sold at a value of 20,000. Now, if you have to find out the cost of closing inventory, then you can reduce your gross profit from it. If it is 25% on cost, then it will be 20% on sale. So 20,000. So gross profit at 20% is included in it. So if you reduce 4,000, finally your cost of closing inventory will be 16,000. Your cost of closing inventory will be 16,000. So yes, guys, so that's it for the video. We have covered all the sums that are there in the ICI study material. And I hope you found this video helpful. In case if you did, please make sure to like, share, and also subscribe to the channel. And don't forget to leave your feedback in the comment section below. And thank you so much for watching. Meet you in the next video. Thank you.